Imagine the web as a vast library and your device as a reader in that library. In this library, when you want a book, you ask the librarian to get it for you. The web operates on a client-server model. You, the reader, are the client, and the server is like the librarian, holding all the information you need. Just as each library has a unique address, each computer on the internet is identified by a unique set of digits known as the IP address. You can type that in your address bar, and you will get to the site. But these numbers are not easily memorable. So, we use an easy-to-remember domain name to access the website instead of the IP address. If there are multiple libraries in your surroundings, and you don't know which library houses your desired book, you would love to have a system that tells you the address of that library. Similarly, when you type in a URL in the address bar, there is a system that finds the IP address of the server where this website is stored. It is known as the domain name system. Understand a domain name system as a phone book where the IP address of the server of each website is stored. Note that multiple domain names can have the same IP address because multiple websites can be stored on that server, just like multiple books can be there in a library. Thus, if the IP address hosts multiple domains, then you will get website content for the domain that the server admin deemed as default. Now that you've got the server's IP address, your browser sends a request message to the server, asking it to send a copy of the website. The web browsers and servers communicate based on a set of rules or protocol known as the HyperText Transfer Protocol. HTTP is a protocol that defines a language for clients and servers to speak to each other. This is like the language you use to request books from a librarian. The web server receives the request and looks for that web page. If the page exists, it sends the client an HTTP 200 OK message and sends the website's files to the browser. This is the same as the librarian saying, "Of course, you can get that book. Here it is," and handing over the requested book to you. But if the server can't find the requested page, it will send an HTTP 404 error message, "Page not found." The internet is a network of networks, and data often has to travel through multiple routers and switches to reach its destination. If the server sends the whole website as a single big chunk, and one of those routers or switches fails, the entire data transmission would be lost. So when data is sent across the web, it is sent in thousands of small chunks called packets. So if a router fails, only the lost packet needs to be resent. Additionally, the packets can be routed along different paths, making the exchange faster and allowing many users to download the same website at the same time. There are mainly two sets of rules, protocols, that ensure that these packets are sent reliably and efficiently. Transmission Control Protocol, or TCP, ensures that all the packets arrive in the correct order and without errors. Internet Protocol, or IP, provides a way to address and route data packets across the internet. The server sends mainly two types of files, assets and code files. Assets are media files like images, video, audio, documents, PDFs, etc. The second type is the code files. Websites are built primarily from HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. But why are there so many different types of files? Why can't we have just one file, the website? Well, they have very different jobs. HTML provides the basic structure and content of a web page. Imagine the website as a house. The HTML is like the bricks and other raw materials needed to build the basic structure of the house. The HTML file contains the web page's content, like the text, paragraphs, headings, images, links, etc. CSS file is responsible for enhancing the appearance and style of the HTML elements. CSS is like the paint, interior design, and decoration of the house. Once the structure is in place, CSS makes everything look good and visually appealing. For example, do you want the background to be white or black? What should be the size of an image? What should be the font of headings, etc.? JavaScript adds functionality and interactivity to web pages. It's like turning a light bulb on or off, or putting on the cooker to cook your food. It defines what happens when a button is pressed, the user clicks, data is entered in forms, and much more. When the web browser gets the HTML page, it scans it to look for links to other files like images, video, audio, CSS, JavaScript, etc. When it finds a link, It sends an HTTP request message to the server asking to send that file. The entire process of sending the request and getting a response from the server is repeated for each asset link. Once the browser has finished loading all the assets linked in the HTML page, the page is finally loaded in the browser window. And there you have it, a whirlwind tour of how the web works, from IP addresses and domain names to packets, protocols, and the building blocks of websites. But we've only scratched the surface. Each topic we've touched on in this video is a fascinating world of its own, with depths waiting to be explored. And as we dive deeper into the world of web development, understanding the best resources to learn from is essential. In this video, I talk about a highly recommended path to become a web developer, which offers a comprehensive, free, and job-focused path with a self-paced curriculum, open-source projects, and GitHub integration from day one. Discover more in this video.